How's it going, film and TV fans? Welcome back to another review here on the Total Shit Productions YouTube channel. Now, having had the recent release of The Fall Guy come out, which, trust me, there'll be a video on that in due course too, I went back to reflect on the filmography of its director, David Leitch. Mr. Leitch has directed a number of other movies, but including things like Atomic Blonde, Deadpool 2, Hobbs and Shaw. He was a co-director on the original John Wick. David Leitch, if you don't know, was a former stuntman who doubled for a lot of different people in Hollywood movies like 20 years ago, and then in the last 10 or so years, more than that even, became a pretty well-known director of highly stylized, highly choreographed action films. Obviously, The Fall Guy being his most recent, but today I wanted to talk about his previous film that I actually think is his best film, and that is 2022's Bullet Train, which is based on a, I believe it's a book, a Japanese book. I believe the book is the second in a trilogy of books. The first book was adapted into a 2015 Japanese film called Grasshopper. But this is David Leitch's Bullet Train, and I just think this movie is a prime example of how perfectly to craft a film, how to have a perfect filmmaking in one movie. It's a prime example of like perfection in filmmaking. I don't mean that it is a masterpiece in every category, but it has every single piece of the filmmaking world, or you know, every element working at a level where it genuinely feels like there is so much love, care and dedication to the craft, and there's so much going on, so much being set up and pulled through with the lighting, the camera setups, the shots, you know, the music as well, the specific choices of music, where music has come up and brought back, where each character has a theme, but sometimes it's also a sung song, like the twins have their theme as I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles, which appears sung by three different people throughout the film at three different times. The original time where it's sung by Engelbert Humperdinck in a version of the song specifically for the film soundtrack. Then the second time when they're walking down the car in slow motion and it's sung by a British punk band. And then the third time where it's sung by composer Dominic Lewis when Tangerine is reminiscing about his time with his brother Lemon. So it's those kind of things. I think Bullet Train has so much perfection in it, but it's not like a masterpiece. Well, I love it and I think it's a fantastic film, but like it's just that really, I think what really stands out the most is the really, really tight-knit script where everything is paced and just plotted perfectly, and there's so much build up and set up. Within, I was even listening to the commentary, and without having to listen to the commentary, you can see within the first opening sequence it sets up the Hornet, it sets up the Momomon, and it sets up various different things that would happen in the rest of the film. And I just think the whole film has this really great element of perfect balance of every single part of the film world, and I think it strikes that balance so perfectly by telling individual character stories, by taking a moment out of the main film to tell the backstory of Bad Bunny's character, but also times where it shows you little glimpses of what could be previous parts. So we see bits of Johannesburg, we see bits of the Bolivia job, we see bits of the White Death, and then we also learn through the White Death as well that there's a character, what you see this character throughout the entire backstory of the White Death, and then it's revealed later on that this character is actually a character played by a very famous actor, and I'm going to butcher this pronunciation, but Hideyuki Sanda, who's a fantastic actor, but as it's revealed later on by him himself that he is this character, and I think that's fantastic. And I think another real strong suit for the film is the fact that it has such a incredible ensemble cast, and I don't think it's one of those times where it's an ensemble cast because it needs to sell the movie, like an animated movie might have, or something like an Ocean's 11 movie where it just builds out the cast so it could have all these names on the poster. It's an ensemble cast because each actor is perfect for the role they're in. So we've got Brad Pitt as Ladybug, Joey King as Prince or the White Death's daughter, Aaron Taylor-Johnson and Brian Tyree Henry as Tangerine and Lemon. You've got Andrew Koji as Kimimura, and as previously mentioned, Hiroyuki Sanda as the Elder. You have Michael Shannon as the White Death. You've got Bad Bunny as the Wolf. Sandra Bullock as Ladybug's handler, which isn't revealed until the very end of the film. Zazie Beetz as the Hornet. And you've got Karen Fukuhara as the Concession Girl, which is a really, really nice little camera because she's fantastic in this film. But you've also got fun little cameos throughout the film, including David Leitch's character during a sequence in which Lemon and Tangerine are arguing about how many people they killed. That's a very fun inventive sequence, I think. That specific sequence, I like to point out as a really great use of going back in time and explaining something. So Lemon and Tangerine are arguing about how many people they killed during a specific job, and Lemon says 16, but Tangerine says 17. So we go on this whole detour where the I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles song performed by Engelbert Humperdinck is played, and they count each person they killed, and then Lemon and Tangerine look at the camera after they've killed someone and continue to count the number. I think that's a really, really just fantastic sequence of just like pure... I think that sequence is just really imaginative and fun and creative as well, in a situation where you could easily just... you know, have them continue to argue, but you have a sequence like that where you actually show it with a funny kind of song and real comedic elements to it. That's what I love about the film, is it has real comedy to it, but it also has real serious moments. So you have funny moments like that, but you also have serious moments when there's deaths of characters much, much later on in the film. But you've also got other cameos like Channing Tatum and Ryan Reynolds, which are really funny and work really, really well for the specific moments they're in. And it's even right the way up to the reveal at the end of the, towards the end of the film, where the whole thing was collated by the White Death to bring each specific, like when the White Death explains the entire plot of the movie, like when he explains the whole, his whole plan, and it's explained that every one of the characters we've seen on, we've been following on the train, was put on the train by White Death because of something they did to him, whether it was directly or indirectly, and he put them on the train so they would all kill each other, and then it would just leave Carver at the very end, and he would kill Carver, and then Brad Pitt goes, but I'm not Carver, because it's revealed at the very beginning of, well, it's told at the very beginning of the film that Brad Pitt's character is filling in for a character called Carver. We never see who this Carver is right until the very end, when it's revealed that this Carver person was the one who killed the White Death's wife. So it's like it, and then that builds from that, it builds from backwards from that, because the White Death's wife was in the car and not the White Death, because these two agents had killed all his people in Bolivia, and those two agents turned out to be Lemon and Tangerine. So that's why Lemon and Tangerine were on the train. And then the reason why the wife couldn't survive the car crash is because it needed a very specific neurosurgeon to perform an operation, and that surgeon was then killed by the Hornets. That's why the Hornets on the train. You know what I mean? It has this level of filmmaking that I wish I could reach. You know what I mean? Like the dedication of the craft and making sure every element flows. But it also doesn't look like that kind of movie either. It has a very big budget Hollywood look, and that's perfectly fine, but I believe that kind of look is what's going to turn a lot of people off and saying this is just a generic Hollywood blockbuster movie, because it has that very specific look. But it's not that whatsoever. It's a very, very well crafted movie, and it's right even down to the things like specific lightings and the use of pool focuses, or focus pools even a lot of the times, and then using reflections in the window and things like that. It's like, it's really, really great for like utilizing every element of the filmmaking process and pushing it up to like 1,000, because it just builds every element individually to a point where quite literally you feel like you know every character inside out by the time it gets to the very end of the movie, and pretty much every one of them is fucking dead. And even then, by that point, when the amount of characters starts dwindling and dwindling and dwindling, and then different things happen, and at some point in the film every single one of the characters interact with at least one other member of the cast as well at like several different points in the film. You see Lemon and Tangerine, they interact with the prince. You see they both also interact with Kimimura as well. Lemon interacts with the elder. Bad Bunny and the wolf and the ladybug interact with each other. You have the hornet, who also interacts with Tangerine, but he also interacts with the ladybug as well. So they all interact with each other, and then it's down to the point where just before you get to the sequence at the end of the film where the White Death reveals everything, it literally is down to Ladybug, Lemon, Kimimura, and the Elder, and Prince. But then and then at the very end of the film, they almost all, bar three of them, fucking die. So it's also brutal as well with its kind of graphic violence, but it's not... it uses that for humour. It's a very comedic film, I'm not gonna lie. It's this perfect blend of action comedy with super serious moments, but also perfectly blended comedic timing moments as well, and callbacks to so many different things, and fate, and all these different bits that gets called back, and it builds its plot to a point where you literally start thinking, like, this is so cool. How do you actually make a film with this many kind of elements to it? And I have to adore it for that reason, because it is genuinely a fantastic film, and I highly recommend it. If you live in the United Kingdom, the movie's currently streaming on Netflix. I believe it's also streaming on Netflix in the States as well. I had the pleasure of watching this movie not once but twice back in cinemas in 2022, and it is still one of my absolute favourite movies of 2022. But it's kind of hard to sit and tell people that I actually think that After Sun and Bullet Train deserve to be in, like, within two positions of each other, because they're completely opposite movies, and it would be unfair, not to either one of them, but to both at the same time, to put Bullet Train and, say, Decision to Leave in the same box. So it's probably, like, my favourite action comedy of 2022, and it is one of my top 10 favourite movies of 2022, but it can't go any higher than that, because it just looks inadvertently, like, wrong to, like, not that I don't think that they're great, because they are fantastic movies, but Bullet Train has something that I don't think After Sun wanted to have, whereas Bullet Train has it, and I'm not going to go any more in that, because this video is about Bullet Train. But yeah, I really highly recommend you give Bullet Train a chance, because it is absolutely fantastic, with every beat landing so perfectly, and David Leitch is a fantastic fucking director, by the way. Genuinely, how he choreographs the action and things like that, you can tell it's a Leitch movie if you are watching highly choreographed action sequences, like in this movie, in Fall Guy, in Deadpool 2, Hobbs and Shaw, Atomic Blonde that I've not seen, John Wick. They're all stylized, highly choreographed movies, but this is the one that I personally think this is David Leitch's best movie. And I'm not saying Lynch, I am saying Leitch, L-E-I-T-C-H, Leitch, David Leitch. Like I said, director of John Wick, Atomic Blonde, Deadpool 2, Hobbs and Shaw, this movie, Bullet Train, and The Fall Guy. So, yeah, I highly recommend it. Give it a chance. The score by Dominic Lewis as well, that's something I want to touch on. Dominic Lewis is a fantastic composer, but what he's really great at is actually adding this singing layer to his score quite often. To his scores. Quite often he tends to... He tends to add his own vocal performances to it, whether it be actual kind of choral stuff or like full-on sing a song like he did with Violent Night. But here he adds vocal layers. Like I said earlier, he does sing I'm Forever Blowing Bubbles at a certain point in the film. You can tell it's him because he's got a very distinctive voice. But he also sings on other tracks as well, which you might be hearing in the background of this video. So, yeah, I just think not even just the score, but also the use of music as well, general pieces of music. It's widely known, if you watch the trailer, that the song Staying Alive by the Bee Gees, performed by several different people throughout the length of the trailer, it's kind of like the theme of the film. And like I said, in that trailer, it's performed in several different languages to match whichever characters on screen. So it's originally sung in Japanese to represent the Muslim people of Japanese, then it switches to Spanish when you see Bad Bunny on screen. So it's things like that's really, really cool. And yeah, it's just a fantastically well-made movie. And yeah, like I said, if you live in the United Kingdom, it's streaming on Netflix. And if you're in the States, I believe it's also streaming on Netflix. You can, of course, get it on Blu-ray, DVD, 4K. I have the Blu-ray here. Yeah, just go check it out. It's a fantastic movie. Thanks so much for watching. And I will see you in the next one.